Welcome to worship today at Friendship Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here. We're praying God will speak to you during this time. The Bible says in Philippians 3, verse 20, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ." We are looking forward to heaven someday, but in the meantime, we're going to celebrate Him, work for Him, and serve Him every day. We are bound for glory.
This world is not my home. I'm here but for a moment. It's all I've ever known. But this world is not my home. The fight is not my own. These burdens aren't my future. The empty tomb has shown I am bound.
Pray with us. Father, indeed, we are people who believe we're bound for glory because we've accepted you into our hearts and lives, because we've read your promises, because we know what your word says. We know we have a great day coming. We know there is a future for us. We know there's an eternity that never ends. So this morning, we celebrate that. We celebrate the journey we're on. We understand the challenges. We ask you to help us all along the way. We know that you provide answers for us, ways for us to make positive decisions, ways to follow you. And I'm praying, Father, that we will be wise and follow you each day, and that we would grow more in you. And as we do, we look forward to the day because we are bound for glory. For it's in precious, your precious name that we pray. Amen. There is a light that's provided by our Heavenly Father. John talks about that in his epistles. We see that throughout his word. It's a marvelous light that we follow every day.
I am not who I once was, defined by all the things I've done. Afraid my shame would be exposed, afraid of really being known. But then you gave my heart a home.
So I walked out of the darkness and into the light, from fear of shame into the hope of life. Mercy called my name and made a way to fly out of the darkness and into the light. Years of keeping secrets safe, wondering if I should change. 'Cause when you're hiding all alone, your heart can turn into a stone. And that's not the way I want to go. So I walked out of the darkness and into the light, from fear of shame into the hope of life. Mercy called my name and made a way to fly out of the darkness and into the light. There's no place I'd rather be. Your light is marvelous, your light. Fear of shame into the hope of life. Mercy called my name and made a way to fly out of the darkness and in to the la 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 la. Thank you.
There is the one who makes a way for us, for our civilization, for our churches, for us as individuals. The waymaker goes ahead of us and takes care of us. Thank you.
worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
Well, good morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 John chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 5 through 10 together. This morning, we're continuing our study through the book of 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. Our series theme is Best Summer Ever. And as we looked at last week, this summer for all of us is going to look a little bit different, isn't it? We will vacation differently. We're going to socialize differently. Our church looks different. The way we do church looks different. The way we're doing growth groups right now looks different. Many things about this summer will be different because we live in a world that is broken. Am I right? Here's the deal, though. This summer may not be unfolding as we all had hoped that it would. But that does not mean that you and I cannot make an impact this summer. We still have an amazing opportunity throughout this summer to impact our community, our homes, and this world for Jesus Christ. Let us become men and women of change, men and women that make it clear that every person has been created in the image of God, that every person without Jesus is a sinner in need of a Savior. As a church, may we go, may we grow, and may we glow. Am I right? Let's do that this summer. Let's impact the world for Jesus Christ. And that's how we can make this the best summer ever. So if you have your Bibles again, turn with me to 1 John chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 5 through 10 together. And this is the word of the Lord. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. Our message point this morning is this: the world is in chaos because we have a sin problem. I hope there's not a single person listening to my voice this morning that would refute that, that would say that we do not have a sin problem, because we clearly have a sin problem. Turn your television on and you see the effects of the broken world that we live in. Folks, times are bad, but I've read the end of the book and I know that things are going to get worse before Jesus Christ returns and puts darkness to bed once and for all. Let's pray together this morning. Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the privilege it is to come before this great faith family and friends that are listening in on this service to hear the truth of your word. Father, we pray that your truth will transform all of us. Father, we pray that as a church and as a body of believers and as people listening in this morning, that we will be agents of change within this world, that we will be a light that penetrates the darkness of this world, that we will be a church and a people that love all people, regardless of who they are or where they're from or how they affiliate, Lord. May we love them just as you love them. And Father, may we share with them the good news of salvation, Lord. I pray this morning that if there is someone listening in that does not have a relationship with you, that today will be the day of their salvation. Lord, we love you and we thank you and pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, notice our first point this morning. It is this: a call to transfer the gospel. In verse 5, the first part, we read, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you. As we looked at last week, James writes with passion and with urgency, doesn't he? James is clearly in the fourth quarter of his life. When he wrote these words, he was somewhere around the age of 85 years old. And so he writes as a man with urgency, recognizing that he's not going to be here much longer. And so he wants to make sure that the message that the Lord had given him gets out to all people. And not only did it get out to all people, it subsequently made its way to us 2,000 years later, didn't it? But what he has to say is important. There were false teachers that were sweeping throughout the land. They had infiltrated the church, and they were preaching a false gospel. They were preaching a false narrative, a false doctrine. And then they were preaching that there was more than one way of salvation and more than one way to get to heaven. And so all of this stuff was going on. And so James is seeking to nip that in the bud and to point people to the way of salvation, which is Jesus Christ. I mentioned this last week, but by way of review, remember that John is the last living disciple. He is the last of the 12 to have been called by Jesus to come and follow him at the very beginning of his earthly ministry. And these 12, and John was one of them, he was able to witness Jesus defy nature. He witnessed Jesus's many miracles. He witnessed the lame walk, the blind see, the mute talk, the deaf hear, the dead to rise to life again. And John on the Mount of Transfiguration literally witnessed Jesus's flesh peel back and the glory of God shine through. And so John witnessed all of these different things, and he also witnessed the physical resurrected body of Jesus, the body that had the nail scars in it. John witnessed all of these things, and he writes as a man that makes it abundantly clear that he is an eyewitness to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. You know, the New English Translation reads verse 5, adds here probably a more literal translation this. Now, this is the gospel message we have heard from him. John is telling his readers and us that we have a gospel message. We have the good news message that the world is in desperate need of. This message concerns Jesus, concerns the way of life. As we looked at last week in verses 1 through 4, John made all of these sayings clear, that Jesus was from the beginning, that he was the word of life, that he is the source of eternal life, that he is the Son of God, and that he is the source of fellowship, and he is the source of joy. John made all of these things clear in the first four verses of chapter 1. This is Jesus, and we are to proclaim him to the world. John expresses these words with such vivid, he makes it so vivid. One commentator said that it is as if there is a ringing in his ears. You know, has there ever been something that you have heard that has just stuck with you for days or weeks or months or maybe for even years? Maybe it was something positive that someone said, or it may have even been something negative that someone said to you that has just always kind of permeated with you, always left a ringing in your ears. Maybe it was a parent, maybe it was a teacher, maybe it was a friend or a loved one, or maybe even a coach. You know, I think all of you know that I love baseball. And if you don't know that, you know that now. I love baseball. I love watching baseball. I love playing baseball. And my senior year was, for me, a pretty special year because I hit multiple home runs. And for me, that was a big deal because I had never hit the ball out of the park before my senior year. And I had this coach, his name was Coach Terry. And every time a batter would get a hold of that ball, he would scream out, "Get out of here!" And he was talking about that ball, and that ball would go on an outward trajectory over that fence. And that is one of those sayings that has always resonated with me. I love that term, get out of here. And it just, that's one of those sayings that has just always rung in my ear. I remember hitting a home run as if it was yesterday, because I didn't do it that often. And that's why it just always kind of stuck with me and provided a ringing in my ears. And that's what the gospel message of Jesus should provide for us, a ringing in our ears, a good news permeating in us. And when it permeates in us, guess what? It gets out of us, doesn't it? Notice our second point this morning. It's this, the gospel truth. In verse 5, we read, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all." This message is an unchanging message. The gospel is the same today as it was 2,000 years ago, isn't it? You know, man may have attempted to make this gospel something that it isn't. They have tried to add to the gospel. They have tried to take away from the gospel message, but the gospel message is the same yesterday, today, and it will be exactly the same tomorrow. The gospel is good news. The gospel is the good news of Christ, and the gospel shows the world the way to salvation. Jesus made it clear that he is the only way to the Father. There are not a million ways to the Father. There are not a dozen ways to the Father. There are not two ways to God the Father. There is one way, and that is through Jesus Christ. Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that Jesus is the only way unto salvation? If you don't believe that, let me encourage you this morning to read God's word. Because Jesus makes it abundantly clear in John 14:6 that he indeed is the only way. And we know Jesus is the absolute truth. God the Father is the absolute truth. God's word is the absolute truth. So you can trust the words that Jesus spoke. The truth John proclaims is this, that God is light. The word light is mentioned somewhere around 275 times in the Bible. It's mentioned 95 times in the New Testament alone. Chuck Swindoll in his commentary shares these words. Light is a single term that captures the essence of God's nature. It represents the holiness and purity of our God. In John's metaphor, God isn't simply a source of light, a being brilliantly illuminated by light or a reflector of light. No, God is light. Again, throughout Scripture, we see this to be true. From the very beginning of creation, God spoke light into existence. In Genesis 1:3. In Psalm 27:1, the psalmist wrote these words, "The Lord Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" In Psalm 36:9, "For with you is the fountain of life. In you light do we see light." Isaiah 61, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." And in John 8:12, again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." In John 12:46, "I have come into the world as light, so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness." And in Isaiah 9:2, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone." We see time and time and time again that Jesus indeed is the light of the world, and that light permeates darkness, doesn't it? God is light, and we're told in Scripture that in him there is absolutely no darkness. And that leads us to our next subpoint. What does light do? Light dispels darkness. In verse 5b, "God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Chuck Swindoll again said, what does this mean? What does it mean that God, that in God there is no darkness? It means that God is all good with nothing bad. He is all pure with nothing impure. He is all clean with nothing dirty. He is all right with nothing wrong. He is all truth with nothing false. God is light, and if you would surrender your life over to him, that will lead you to eternal life. If you would place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ this morning, you too can be led toward the light and experience eternal life in your life. The truth of the gospel, again, is to be proclaimed, and it is to be shared. In 2 Corinthians 4:6, Paul wrote these words, "For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." You and I have been set apart by God the Father, and we get to shine the light of Christ with the world. We get to shine the light of Christ to those that we do life with. John Falkorner said, "I have but one candle of life to burn, and I would rather burn it out in a land filled with darkness than a land flooded with light." You and I get just one chance in all of human history to impact this world for Jesus Christ. We get but one candle of life to burn. How are we going to burn our candle? And for whom are we going to burn it? We live in the midst of utter darkness. If you don't believe it, turn your television on and you will see the reality of the darkness that we are living in. We see on a daily basis people killing each other on our streets. We are derogating one another and destroying one another with our words. There's no telling how many millions upon millions of dollars have been destroyed over the past week because of the rioting that has been occurring in many of our cities. There is so much darkness in our world. But what we know is that the light of Christ can displace all darkness within this world. C.T. Studd said, "Some want to live within the sound of church or chapel bells. I want to run a rescue shop a yard from the gates of hell." Isn't that just some powerful words? Good words this morning. May you and I seek to lead people away from the gates of hell and toward a relationship with God the Father. Notice the purpose of the gospel. The first purpose of the gospel is quite obvious. It's to bring us to God. That is why Jesus came. He came to provide a way for you and I to be reconciled to God. But before we can be reconciled to God, we must first be made right before God. And in order to be made right before God, we must be forgiven of our sins. And we are forgiven for our sins when we confess our sins and come unto God the Father through faith. Has that happened in your life? Have you repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus and got right with God the Father? If not, what is keeping you from doing that? The purpose of the gospel is to bring us to God. But notice many falsely claim belief in God. Notice man's flawed claim. In verse 6, we read, "If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth." Here was and is the problem. Many, many, many people throughout human history have claimed to be followers of Christ. They have led their homes in such a way that they teach their family to follow after Christ. They have sat in our churches and claim to be followers of Christ. They have sat in government offices and stood before their constituents and claimed to be followers of Christ. They have stood in our pulpits and beat against the lecterns and claimed to be followers of Jesus. Yet there is no evidence whatsoever of the light of Christ in them, just utter darkness. John says, if we claim to have fellowship with Jesus, yet continue in our sin, then we ourselves are liars. You know, I love what Tony Evans wrote regarding this passage. He said, fellowship with God is not validated by your lips. It is validated by your walk. Praising God and shouting amen have their place, but intimacy with God must be demonstrated through actions, not merely through our vernacular. Here is the deal. You and I are never going to have or live a sinless life. You know that, don't you? We all want to be sinless, I hope, but we're never going to be sinless as long as our spirit is still clothed in this flesh. You know, this past Sunday, we had the opportunity to serve the men and women that make up Church Under the Tree in Plano. There was a young man there who was really struggling with his sin nature. He knows God, and he knows the truth found within the Word of God, but he struggles with substance abuse. This was a young man, probably in his early 20s. He testified before all of the men and women that were at this church service, testified how broken he was because of his sinfulness. He shared how he was stuck in a pattern of sin. He didn't want to sin. He tried his best to keep from sinning, but somehow he always found himself in a place, or regularly finds himself in a place where he's given in to his flesh and succumbing to the pressures of participating in drugs. This man wanted to be sin-free. But understand, you and I will never be sinless, but we can certainly sin less. Let me say that again. We will never be sinless, but we can certainly sin less. As we walk with Christ, and the closer we get to Christ, and the more we dive into the Word of God, the more we're transformed into His image. And as we're transformed into His image, guess what? We do sin less, don't we? Paul wrote these words in Romans chapter 7, verses 15 through 20. This passage of scripture that most of us are familiar with, where Paul talks about wrestling with his flesh, wrestling with the temptations. And he wrote these words, "For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me." That's a mouthful right there, isn't it? Go back and read that after we're done with this message. But do you ever find yourself there? Do you ever find yourself sharing the sentiment that Paul had here? You ever find yourself doing what you do not want to do? You ever find your spirit at war with your flesh? We all have been there, and we all will continue to be there. But that does not mean that we should be satisfied with being there. We should fight just as Paul fought to sin less every single day. Notice the third subpoint here is the reward. In verse 7 we read, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light. We have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Walking. What does it imply? Man, it implies action, doesn't it? When I walk, I am doing something. I am actively pursuing after something. It applies forward momentum. As we walk with Christ in the light of Christ, we will find ourselves growing and going and glowing for Christ. As believers who walk in the light, we get to enjoy fellowship with God, and we get to enjoy fellowship with one another. Right here in verse 7 again, we read, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another." We have fellowship with one another. We get to do life with one another. Man, that's what the church is all about. Man, Jesus died for the church so that we could come together to strengthen one another within the body of Christ. Iron sharpens iron. Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered, I am right there in their midst." We get to fellowship with one another as believers in Jesus Christ. That is one of the rewards of being a Christ follower. Another reward of being a Christ follower is this, that the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So the reward is fellowship with one another and fellowship with God. You may ask, what does it look like to walk with Jesus? What does it mean to walk with God? I shared this a couple of weeks ago during our senior sermon, our senior day celebration that we had here at church. But when we walk with Christ, it means and looks kind of like this. We hear the word. We get to hold the word of God. We get to hide the word in our hearts. We find help in the word. We sing the word, and we pray the word, and we respond to the word. That's what it means to walk with Christ. We do all of those things, and the more we do those things on a regular basis, the closer we're going to get with God the Father. And the closer we are to God the Father, the reward of that is the blood of Jesus, but also the reward of that is that we're being made more into the image of Jesus, and we're sinning less as a result. John is going to continue to elaborate on the blood of Jesus within their next point. So notice this. Notice the reality of sin. Again, we have a sin problem in our world today, don't we? The reality is this. We have all sinned, and we are all sinners. Romans 3:23, we read, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." It doesn't say that some have sinned or most have sinned or only those outside the doors of the church have sinned. It says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And we see here in four subpoints this morning, this. Notice the presence of sin. John wrote, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us." A person who claims to be without sin claims that they are free from the penalty of sin. Such a declaration is damning, isn't it? This person says that they have no sin, but makes it clear that they, but God makes it clear that they do. They say that they have no need of a Savior, but God says they do. There have always been those that feel as if they are without sin, as if they are morally upright, as if they are kind of, as they've maybe received a vaccine from sin, and that they are not prone to sin. But God makes it very, very clear that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And Romans 6:23 makes it clear that the wages of sin is death. The consequences for our sin is eternal death, eternal separation from God in a real place called hell. If a person does not confess their sins before God, then they will die in their sins and spend eternity separated from God in a real place called hell. John goes on and makes a beautiful declaration. And that is this, the confession of sin. In 1 John 1:9, this is a passage of scripture that if you've been in the church for any period of time, you have probably memorized this passage of scripture. But it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. When you and I confess our sins before God, we are in total agreement with God and his word, what it says about sin, that we are sinners in need of a Savior. And we recognize that Jesus is our Savior, and he has provided atonement for our sins, that he has provided a way for our sins to be forgiven. And again, we read in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death. What we deserve is death, but because of the work of Christ on the cross, we can be forgiven and we can seek forgiveness from Jesus. The wages of sin is death, but notice this but here. It says, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. When we confess our sins before God the Father, we are told that we will be forgiven of those sins and that we will be given the gift of eternal life. The assurance of knowing that when we die, that we will spend eternity with Christ. Notice the result of confession. It is this, cleansing from sin. We read here that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Christ this morning wants to forgive you and cleanse you from all your sins. He wants to set you free from the penalty of sin. He wants to set you free from the bondage of sin. He wants to set you free from the prison that you are living in this morning. Repent and be saved this morning. There is cleansing that comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus wants to cleanse you this morning of all of your sin. All it takes for you is to confess your sins before Jesus, repent of those sins, and ask Jesus into your life and declare him to be Lord and Savior of your life. In closing, John gives a stern warning. Notice this stern warning, the denial of sin. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Notice, to deny your sin is to call God a liar. And to call God a liar and not repent of your sin is to say to God that you do not need him and that you are just fine living independently of him. Folks, to do such a thing will result in eternal death. It will result in the fires of hell. Now, I'm not a hellfire and brimstone kind of preacher. I don't preach on hell much, but hell is real. And the consequences of not having a relationship with Jesus is eternal separation from God. The consequences of denying the truth of God is eternal separation from him. The consequences of not experiencing the atonement of Jesus is eternal separation from God in a real place called hell. Let me challenge you this morning. Do not deny Jesus this morning, but come unto him. Come unto him and experience his grace. Come unto him and experience his love. Come unto him and experience his life. As we close this morning, let us all be men and women that are committed to transferring the gospel of Jesus from us to other people. Let's be, if you don't know Jesus this morning, let me encourage you to confess your sins before him and experience Christ's cleansing within you and begin a new life today with Jesus. Here's what we know, and we can be absolute certain of. It is this: Jesus is the way. And because he is the way, let us share him with others. And if you don't know him, may you believe upon him this morning. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the opportunity, Father, just to study your word, to dive into your word. Thank you for these words that John wrote some 2,000 years ago. Thank you that they are just as true today as they were the day that he penned them. Father, what we can gain from this word, your word, from this message this morning, is the reality, Father, that as believers, we have a responsibility to transfer the gospel, to share the gospel, to proclaim the new good news of salvation with other people. For those without Jesus, there is this glorious promise within God's word that if we confess our sins before you, before God the Father, if we repent of those sins, you will cleanse us and you will forgive us. And as the psalmist declared, you will remove our sins as far as the east is from the west. So I pray this morning that if there is someone listening, Father, to my voice that has never entered into a relationship with you, Father, that your Holy Spirit will speak to them and convict them and, Father, lead them to repent of their sins and to cry out to you to be Lord and Savior of their life. And may they experience the glorious cleansing that comes when your blood, Father, cleanses us. When your blood, Father, runs through us. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this morning. We thank you for the beautiful words that we read in your word. Father, may all of us leave this morning empowered with your truth. May all of us leave this morning, Father, with a hunger, Father, to make you known to those that we come in contact with. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. If you're listening to my voice this morning and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, now I want to invite you to place your faith and trust in Jesus. If you don't know how to do that, then call me, email me. You see here on the screen, you can reach me at 972-562-6865. You can email me at fbctruth@gmail.com. You can leave a message on our Facebook account or our YouTube account. We'd love to share with you more about how you can enter into a relationship with God the Father this morning. God loves you. And he loves you so much that he sent his son Jesus to die for you. And you can enter into a relationship with him this morning by trusting in him. And I encourage you to do that this morning. I want you to know that I love you, that I'm praying for you, and I'm looking forward to us coming back together in person to worshiping the Father together. You have a great day and a blessed day.